Some of you may know that I work as a marine engineer on merchant ships. And although usually I post travel videos, every once in a blue moon I like to make some engineering videos as well, especially if someone asks for it. Recently, one of the students actually sent me a message on Instagram and asked me if I could do some basic explanation about the sea chest on board. So in today's video, I'm gonna give it a shot. Let's go. The sea chest is part of the seawater system on board. Some of the other components of the seawater system are the cooling water pumps, the heat exchangers, also known as the LT coolers, the seawater overboard valve, of course, the sea suction filters, also known as the sea chest, and last but not the least, the associated piping along with the controllers for regulating the parameters, basically the temperatures. The seawater system on board consists of two sea chests, one on each side. One of them is the high sea chest and the other is called the low sea chest. Visually, not much different. They almost look the same. But they're called that way because of the different height or the different depth at which they are fitted onto the ship's hull. On screen right now are the manual isolating valves for the sea chests. They are identical as well, except for the marking done on them for easy identification. The sea chest needs to be isolated and then depressurized before opening up for inspection. As you can see here, the high sea chest valve is open and the low sea chest valve is shut. In simple words, sea chest acts like a gate, and through this gate, seawater is allowed to enter the engine room through valves and piping in a controlled manner. But along with the seawater also comes a lot of unwanted marine organisms, example, the fishes, planktons, shells, and so on. These are problematic because once they enter into the seawater system, they cause fluctuation in the seawater pressure. And in severe cases, they even cause erosion of the impeller on the seawater pumps. Also, they can choke up the central coolers, causing heat imbalance, thereby causing the engine parameters to exceed its limit. Thus, it is highly essential to filter out all these marine organisms to maintain the seawater system's cooling efficiency. By the way, the central coolers, they look like this, and they have this long cylindrical filter inserts inside, which look like that. To access the sea chest filter, we have to remove the lid. But before we remove the lid, we have to make sure that it's isolated and depressurized. This is done by opening and then keeping open the vent valve. Once it's confirmed that the isolating valves are holding and the system is depressurized, the securing nuts and bolts on the sea chest lid can be removed. Note that it's always a good practice to keep 3 or 4 of the nuts and bolts loosened but still in place. I would say at least 2. The reason for that is simple. In case when you start lifting the lid and you see the water starts to come out for whatever reason, you have isolated and depressurized and the vent and everything, but still the water comes out, you can just drop the lid and bolt it in place and prevent the engine room from flooding. But if you have all the bolts off, then you lift the lid and then the water comes off, it's just gonna be very, 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 very complicated, and you will not have the time to stop engine room flooding or to put the lid down and then align the bolts that time because it's already too late. So, lift the lid just a little bit using the chain block and see that there's no water coming out. If all is okay, then lower the lid again, remove these nuts and bolts, and of course the next step is to lift off the lid completely and secure it safely away from the workplace. Depending on the design, the sea chest lid may incorporate what is called the sacrificial anodes for the marine growth prevention system, or it could be that the ship has a separate sea chest only for the MGPS. On this ship, we have the latter design, so the information about the MGPS and stuff will be later in the video. With regards to the sea chest, the next step is to retrieve the filter and clean it up. The filter itself can have different designs, but the concept remains the same. It should be cleaned thoroughly and checked for signs of damage, corrosion, and the anodes, if fitted, should be renewed depending on the condition. By the way, did you notice that I've not drained the sea chest of water for this inspection? Ideally, you should drain the whole thing, jump inside and inspect the rubber lining on the valves, the coating of the sea chest itself, and in general, the condition, corrosion, wear, and any signs of damage. Now, I'm a regular on this ship. I've been here for the last 2 years. And so I do this every second month. So every second month I do drain the whole thing and then I do the thorough inspection. Because I've been here for 2 years, I sort of know the condition and I'm like, okay, I'm gonna do this every second month instead of every month. But if you're going on a ship and you're there for the first time, or you don't know what the condition is, or if you cannot find any photos from the previous inspections, best is to drain the whole thing, go down, inspect it yourself so you know where you stand, as in what is the actual condition. And based on this initial inspection, you can then decide how often you want to inspect it again. Every month, every second month, or so on. Once cleaned, put the filter back inside. Drop the lid, put the bolts and nuts, tighten it, open the water valve, purge the air out from the sea chest, and check for leaks. If all is satisfactory, it's good to go. You can either put the system back in use or keep the sea chest standby while you use the other. And you also have to take photos and write down all your findings from the inspection and your comments into the biofouling management plan. This is usually done by chief engineer, but you could do it as well. It's basically he who signs it. Next, coming to the MGPS. As I said before, we have a separate chest for it. Concept is the same before removing the lid, that is isolate and depressurize. The checks on the compartment are also basically the same as the sea chest. The only add-on here are the anodes. Check the condition with reference to the previous inspection findings. Too much or too little erosion on these anodes means that there could be a fault with the current settings. A general cleanup on the anode surface is required so that the loose particles fall off. Also, check the length of the anodes remaining. I mean, around 20 to 25 centimeters of the exposed surface area at correct current settings is sufficient to last 2 to 3 months. Remember, a new anode comes with a rubber heat shrink tube on it. This should not be totally removed before installation. Only a small section of it, maybe 20 centimeters, 25 centimeters from bottom, should be cut off and then it should be installed. Some people wrongly remove the entire rubber tube. As a result, the anode starts getting eroded from the point nearest to the current application, that is, from top. And that results in a bottleneck, this kind, which eventually leads to the anode material breaking off due to its weight. Now this is a complete waste because there's so much anode which just gets wasted and there's no way to reverse it once it starts. Once satisfied with the condition, box it back in the reverse sequence as opened. All right, one question. Why do we have sea chest at different heights on both sides? One of them is a high sea chest, the other is a low sea chest. Why can't we have sea chest on the same height on both sides? Let me know your answers as a comment. Also, if you have doubts about this topic or any other topic, just feel free, post it as a comment below and I'll get back to you as soon as I can. For now, this is it. I hope you found the video informative. If you did, please subscribe to my channel or at least give this video a like. I'll see you in the next one. Till then, keep exploring. This is Rahul for RoamerRealm, and thanks for watching.